Have you not known, and have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning, and have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain, and spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. He brings princes to nothing, and he makes the judges of the earth useless. Scarcely shall they be planted, and scarcely shall they be sown. Scarcely shall their stock take root in the earth, when he will also blow on them, and they will wither, and the whirlwind will take them away like stubble. To whom then will you liken me? Or to whom shall I be equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these things, who brings out their host by number. He calls them all by name and by the greatness of his might and the strength of his power. Not one is missing. Let's pray. Lord, not one of all the stars that you have created is missing. You call them all by name. And Lord, not one of your children that you have called is lost or missing. Jesus said, no one can snatch us out of his hand. And so we are safe and secure here, Lord. You call us all by name. You know each one here this morning, standing in their place right now, you know their name. And Lord, in ancient times, you turned to your Son and to the Holy Spirit and said, let us make man in our image. We are made in the image of God, this God we just read about. And Lord, though we do not appear the way we will, there will be a day when this chrysalis will split and we will emerge in your likeness. We will rise the way your Son, our Savior, rose from that grave, because the grave cannot hold us. One day, one glorious day, we will be with you, and so will we be there forever. In Jesus' name, we give thanks.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you so much. Please be seated. We are beginning to lay down building blocks to the joy of every Christian life, and that is the resurrection of Jesus Christ, as we commemorate that this coming Sunday. To do that, we are having once again, and I believe if I'm correct, this is our 30th Sunrise service in the city of Santa Maria. 30th. Now, this will be Lucy and my 24th, but what a joy to celebrate Jesus early in the morning. And every year we do, there are people that call the police and say, get down there. Bunch of crazy people doing weird stuff in the parking lot at Calvary Chapel. And the sun's not even up. But we're going to keep doing it. And it's a joy to do it. Please join us. I know the time has changed. It's dark in the morning. It's 6 a.m. I'm asking you to please come. And once again this year, we are going to be celebrating communion at our sunrise service only with olive wood cups, handmade from the city of Bethlehem in Israel. I don't know how much longer we can continue to do that, but we're doing it this year, and we have enough, we believe, to celebrate with everyone that comes. So please come and be a part of that. I know that there are families that come from other churches, and everyone is welcome, please. But in particular, I think it's a unique celebration to people, perhaps, that have never been to a sunrise service, or families that just don't go to church. Or maybe this is one of their two times in a year they go to church, you know? for what they call Easter and then also for Christmas Sunday. Well, it doesn't matter. They're welcome to come. And I hope that you do as well. And afterwards, of course, we celebrate with tons of food in the foyer. And of course, that's what Calvary Chapel always does. So here we are. We've got door hangers that talk about not only the play that's coming this week, but also the sunrise service, cards. Pick them up while they last. Isaiah chapter 40. What in the world are we doing there? This is Palm Sunday. Why aren't we talking about palm trees? Well, there is a message behind this message that I think is a stirring one. And we'll see if you agree. Isaiah, what a unique individual. We know only that which is recorded in Scripture regarding him. There, of course, are traditions that have been written many hundreds of years after him, speaking about just what a unique prophet he was in the city of Jerusalem just prior to the Babylonians falling down on the city and destroying it. One of the things that he chronicles is, of course, not only what prophetically was said to the city of Jerusalem, but also he chronicles some of the history of the kings of Judah during those days. And he brings a unique perspective with respect to one of my favorite kings, Hezekiah, and an individual by the name of Cyrus. Now, in Isaiah 45, this isn't in my notes, it's interesting that Isaiah, this really does prove he's a prophet, 150 years before a fellow by the name of Cyrus would be born, Isaiah predicts that Cyrus would come to the city of Jerusalem and in a sense, be a deliverer of Jerusalem. 150 years later, of course, during the Persian Empire that overtook the Medes and of course, also the Babylonians in Nebuchadnezzar's day, there would come a king by the name of Cyrus who would stand on the outskirts of Jerusalem and stay his hand against that city because a priest came out to Cyrus and showed him his name in the Holy Scriptures, written by a weirdo prophet 150 years earlier. And Cyrus said, I will stay my hand against this city, for surely it is the city of God. I love that kind of stuff. Now, Isaiah was weird. I got to admit, he got away with stuff that I couldn't get away with today. He preached in the city of Jerusalem just wearing his Speedo, his jockey shorts. And you know, he said things that nobody liked. He was set against the pagan society. He spoke about a God with a very peculiar, particular interest in the nation of Israel, with a love that superseded the love of any pagan god that was ever up to that point known. And Isaiah described this God not only through personal experience, we will speak about that in what Isaiah records in Isaiah 6 about actually entering into the realm, the tabernacle of God, and seeing God in this interaction dialogue with him. But Isaiah seemed to know things about our Heavenly Father, about the grand creator Jesus, that others did not know. And that blows my mind, to coin a Raul Ries saying. Actually, it blows my mind. That's what he said. But you know, as a young man growing up in my little hometown, that was instilled in me in a very young age, an awe, a sense of the grandeur of creation. I didn't know what to attach that to. But it seemed as though often in my young life, I grew up about 50 feet from the ocean. And my dad would take us to the beach. And you probably remember in the early 60s when there was the embargo with Cuba, and everyone thought that, you know, ICBMs were going to come across from Cuba and destroy everything, and you know, to really get us school kids ready for a nuclear attack, they practiced hiding underneath our desks at school, and that certainly would have done a good, it would have protected us, I'm sure. No doubt about that. But my dad would take our family down to the beach, and he would stand us there. And he'd say, I want you to look in that direction. He says, if something happens, get to the beach and start walking south into Mexico, and we'll meet somewhere along that pathway. There was fear in those days, and now our president is landing as I speak in Cuba. Things have changed somewhat with the nation of Cuba. I still don't trust them. But there was an awe in my life with standing on the beach and seeing the pounding waves in the winter and the high tides that would, well, there were many times when my dad would take us down at midnight. I don't know, some of you may have done this yourself along the beaches of Southern California in a full moon and attended the Grunion Run. Anybody know what that is? Well, you are a unique individual. You really are. And we would pick them up in buckets, and it was just it was in the moonlight of midnight. It was just really a cool thing. Get back to Scripture here. In this sense of awe, I grew up learning from my father a keen sense of my surrounding and a sense that I was just a spectator, not a participant. I didn't create anything, didn't build anything, but I lived in the awesome presence of someone who created something that at least in my early years, I had no idea who it was. And then now Scripture describes that, in fact, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 2, defining verse 1, what faith is, we're told in verse 2 that Jesus himself built, created all things that exist. He, asah, out of nothing, brought something that Job would describe as so awesome that all the host of heaven began to worship and shout with joy. I wondered at it early. When did this all happen? My uncle was a monkey, or did I come from the primordial soup? Even in the 60s, evolution was beginning to rear its ugly head in a more powerful, theoretical way than ever before. I discovered in my early 20s that with my encounter with Jesus, that something had come into my life that would change me, that would redescribe and redefine everything I had ever known previously. At the time, I was a student in veterinary science at Cal Poly Pomona. I was engaged very deeply into the veterinary world and working with Arabian horses at the W. Kellogg Arabian Horse Center down there. And my life was horses. My life, I thought, was going to be one of being a horseshoer. I worked with a horseshoer at Arabian Horse Center. My senior project was shoeing horses, and actually wrote a workbook for the class that was for many years being used by Cal Poly Pomona. And when I met Jesus, I couldn't look at horses in the same way. I mean, there were so many midnight watches where in our foaling rooms, I would be up all night to call the veterinarian when, and I'm not kidding this, $1 million foals would be born under my supervision. $1 million foals. And the magnificence of how God had prepared every foal to come out of its mother's womb with little caps of cartilage on the outside of its hoofs that falls off within moments after being born, but protects the mother's womb from the sharpness of its little hoofs, leaves its mother is on its feet in moments and ready to nurse. There were many times when, even with the finest of breeding and the finest of genetic work, there were foals that we knew would die within their first year. And I can't tell you what it's like to have a foal laying on your lap as you hold its head down and the veterinarian injects potassium chloride into its artery. And this beautiful little thing, so gorgeously created, just begins to stop breathing. And you wonder, Lord, is this your doing? Have you ever wondered, where did the stars come from? Have you ever wondered, how is it that I have the blessing of living in this place, in this time, with a love for the loving, for the living God? I want to say to you that there has been little known that would confirm what Isaiah knew up until rather recently, interestingly enough. Isaiah would write in chapter 40. Now, once again, I tell you, he is writing this to the audience of the city of Jerusalem that are largely pagan, that are in a very, very powerful social and political movement in Jerusalem, are very antagonistic to the old Hebraic ways. They're very engaged in the modern religion of pagan gods, sacrificing their children, burning incense in front of idols. That was the modern idea. And here comes a man, a very odd man, preaching the Almighty God by beginning his discourse with actually speaking of being in the presence of God and being commissioned by God, being impressed upon his lips with a coal from the burning altar of God, because the lips of the prophet were unclean, because he serves a people who speak praises to pagan gods, and therefore their lips are unclean as well. And he says, I send you into a people that will hate you. And tradition tells us that it was at the end of Isaiah's career that the people of Jerusalem placed him inside a hollow log and they sawed him in two while he was alive. All to hear the agony and cries of a human being commissioned by God to tell people what they didn't want to hear. Now, Isaiah writes in chapter 40, verse 21, have you not known? Have you not heard? Haven't you been told, even from the very beginning? Have you not understood from the foundation of the earth? What Isaiah is rehearsing, as it were, through what Grecians in philosophy would call a rhetoric, or questions that don't need an answer. He's asking them things that he knows they have the answer to. But at this point in the history of Judah, of Jerusalem, they're refusing to answer. They're refusing to acknowledge that there is an Almighty God that created everything, and in fact, by his favor, has greatly favored the nation of Israel, greatly favored the city of Jerusalem, fit into the southern part of Judah. And that all the providence of God has led them to here having this odd man speak of odd things all for the purpose of a revival. I know that Isaiah's heart begged for revival, begged for men's hearts to think of something other than themselves, to stop worshiping pagan gods with the uncleanness of their lips, to bow down to graven images, and to seek the Holy One of Israel who created them for his own purpose. We know, of course, that this same idea is repeated by the Apostle Paul to the Church of Rome when he says in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through 20, he says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all impiety, unrighteousness, and the unrighteousness of people who choose to suppress the truth in righteousness." In other words, they know the truth, and out of their deceitful, sinful hearts, they choose not to reveal the truth. And so has been the philosophy of science in this world. Knowing the truth, they suppress the truth because they can't reveal the fact that they were wrong. They can't admit the fact that, you know, all the stuff that we believed since Copernicus was just dead wrong. Even though the far imbalance of experimental truth lends to the fact that this little planet stands in the center of all that is in the universe. I don't know if you got a chance to buy or come and see the principal movie while we had it. This is the last DVD on Earth. No, just in this church. And if you want it, you can buy it in the bookstore after the service today. But it's a stirring documentary on the outcome of experiments, including the Planck satellite that was sent into space for the sole purpose of finally and for the last time determining what this cosmic microwave background in the universe actually is. And they know now that all the residual of the universe in these waves point to one thing. Every direction they look in the universe points to one thing, and that is this little planet. And they're hoodwinked by this. They don't know what to do with it because it must mean that Earth is a very special place filled with very special beings that have a very unique sense to a position in the mighty God's universe that in fact he did send his only son to this planet. The creator of this universe to this planet to die an ugly death and to shed his blood to wash you of your sins. This is how, of course, Romans chapter 1 goes on to say, for in verse 20, from the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, both his eternal power and deity, are discerned clearly, understood and seen clearly, being understood in the things created, so that all people are without excuse. Everyone is without excuse. I had a sense of that. I don't know if you've ever been on a beach when 20-foot waves hit. It's just, wow. Wow. Verse 22 of Isaiah 40. He is the one. It is he who created all these things, who sits above the circle of the earth, who sees its inhabitants like grasshoppers. That's how great he is. He's the one who stretches out the heavens like a veil and spreads them out like a tent to live in. Let's talk about this tent. Let's talk about this veil that he spreads out over the face of the earth. For I don't know if you're like me, but I get up very early. And in the early morning, standing out in my backyard, hoping my little doggie will do her constitutional, I look up in the sky, and the stars, they say one thing. You stand under the awesome eye of a God who loves you greater than anything else that he has ever made. And the stars behold even the very invisible attributes of he who sent his only begotten Son. But I want to show you something else about this canopy of stars that wakens me every morning and sends me to bed each night. We're told in verse 25, I know I skipped verses 23 and 24, but it's because of time. God asking through Isaiah, the city of Jerusalem, to whom will you compare me and who am I equal? To this God over here, Chemosh or Marduk, or to any of these false gods, you would compare me to them? Who among them, which one of these created the universe? Which one of these is high and lifted above all things that exist? Lift your eyes on high, he says in verse 26, and look. Which of these pagan gods created this? Which of them is the one who brings out their host by number? And he calls each of them by their name. Because the one who does this is the one that is great of power, mighty of power, and has never lost a single one. I'm impressed by the fact that when God made the heavens and the earth, we are told in the record of Job, as God is dialoguing with Job concerning the creation of all that exists, he asked Job, so what do you know about creation? And God tells Job, here's what I want you to know. Job 38, verse 4, where were you at the laying of the foundation of the earth when I out of nothing created that which is now this vibrant planet? Tell me if you possess understanding. Verse 5, who determined its measurement? Yes, do you know? Or who stretched the measuring line upon it? On what were its bases sunk? And who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars were singing together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. There were those that knew, because at the point when God breathed life into this universe and in an instant created all things that exist, we're told in the record of Genesis chapter 1 that when God called light to be, literally the Hebrew says, and God said, be light, comma, light be. God said, I want light. And in that instant, that unique thing we call light was created that exhibits qualities and capacities that we still don't fully understand. Be light. Light. And he set the planets. And he set a star in the midst of this planet. And the night and the day. And God placed these things that we would attend to his creative genius. Now, what we know from what he told Job is that there were beings in heaven that witnessed the very creation of all that exists. And their response when God said, be light, light be, is that in verse 7, the morning stars were singing together and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Oh, amazing. Wouldn't you have loved to have been there? Wouldn't it have been grand to be in the audience when God created all the heavens and the earth? In the ancient Semitic world, in fact, many of the people in the Old Testament believed that the stars were angels, that they were a part of what the Semitic world called the Elohim or divine council of God. There were other religions, as it were, than Judaism or Hebraism, that believed in a host of heaven because they couldn't otherwise understand what these twinkling things with very unique formations we call constellations were. And how it was that in the seasons of the life of the earth, that they moved, and during some seasons they were visible and other seasons they were not. And they began to chronicle such things. And they began to wonder, even as you would suspect any one of us without science would wonder, what are these things? Well, Scripture tells us some more about the heavenly host. In fact, at some point after the divine council, this host of heaven that had gathered with Jesus when by faith he created all things that exist, they shouted for joy, and at some point after that, there was a creature by the name of Lucifer, light bearer, interestingly enough is what his name means, a bearer of light. He decided, as Isaiah also tells us in Isaiah chapter 14, that he would do something unique among all the beings created in those days, to presume something that was unique among all things created. And Isaiah 14, verse 13, tells us what that was. Isaiah says, "And you yourself, speaking of Lucifer, you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven." Note this, please. "I will ascend to heaven, and I will raise up my throne above the stars of God." Now, I want you to just remember, highlight that, you know, bold print that with respect to your Bibles in your minds this morning. Because what Isaiah is saying about this creature, this created being, sorry, Mormons, he is not the brother of Jesus. He was a created being who was created by Jesus. Ding dong, hello. Presumed within his heart as he looked at the grand creator of this universe sitting upon his throne, who, as Isaiah said, the train of his robe filled the tabernacle of heaven. And at his voice, the very pillars of that tabernacle shook. Somewhere in Lucifer's heart, as Isaiah describes, he looked at that glorious being whom we know to be Jesus. And he said within his heart, "I will raise my throne above his throne. And I will raise it above even the stars of God." Now, Isaiah might have been thinking in mythological terms, but in fact, could it be very scriptural terms? That's my proposal. That in fact, Lucifer was proposing not just to raise his throne above the triune God whom we know, but very specifically, Lucifer wanted to dethrone Jesus himself. To dethrone Jesus himself. And I would venture to say that the great conquest from Genesis 1 through Revelation chapter 22 is the conquest of Lucifer dethroning Jesus. Now imagine this. When about 2,000 years ago, the heralds trumpeted across heaven that the Almighty God had come to earth, Emmanuel, that the creator of all the universe had emptied himself and stepped from his throne of glory, had shed the great robe of the stars of heaven, the veil, the tabernacle of the host of heaven, and now was a wee child within a manger in the city, the little, dirty, dusty shepherd's town of Bethlehem. Oh, I could see Lucifer just, "Oh, now I've got him. Oh man, this is what I've been waiting for. And now I can get rid of this guy for once and for all." And you know, of course, the concerted effort of the realm and the dominion of the demonic world has been to destroy Jews, to annihilate this race, to ethnically cleanse the universe of anything associated with the choice of God, with the beloved of Christ. And now Lucifer can see within his very the grasp of his hand the capacity, the possibility of killing God himself. Oh, I can see the writhing demons of heaven joining with Lucifer in their anguished, sulfuric hatred for he who stepped out of heaven and took the role of a baby in a stone manger in a dirty little town. And so all of Jesus' young life and all of Jesus' life was vexed with this hatred, this process, this idea that he could be killed. And so they took the sword to every child under 2 years old. Luciferian in thought, who else would determine to murder babies 2 years old and younger for the sole purpose across Israel to just kill Emmanuel, the living God? I will ascend to heaven, Isaiah 14:13 said. I will raise my throne upon the stars of God, and I will sit on the mountain of assembly on the summit of Zaphon. And I will ascend to the high places of the cloud, and I will make myself like the Most High. I will finally be God. Now, next Sunday, I've got two pretty unique sermons. One at the sunrise service that I think is going to stir you with respect to the capacity of the blood of Christ to wash all who believe in him from every wound of sin that there is. Amen. I think it's something that you haven't seen before. In the 8:30 and 10:30 service, we're going to talk about how it is that Jesus was not only sent to the cross, but to the befuddlement, we're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, that not even the demonic world believed that Jesus could rise from the dead. And Paul writes, they wouldn't have killed him if they knew he was capable of that. Scripture is repeated over and over about who it is that sits rightly on his throne above all things that exist. You recall last Sunday how I remarked to something that is very remarkable in the New Testament. It's only mentioned twice. And in James chapter 5, verse 4, it is mentioned for the purpose of stirring the hearts of those James is writing to, which is typically the Christians of Jerusalem. He attended as the main minister over the seven churches of Jerusalem. And he wrote this, James chapter 5, verse 4. This is from the New King James Version. Indeed, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, who worked and sweat with their backs, you kept back their pay by fraud. And they cry out to me, and the cries of the reapers have reached the ears of, now note this, the Lord of Sabaoth. The Lord of Sabaoth. Now, you know that the New Testament was written in Greek, don't you? Every one of you know that. Just nod your head like you know that. Now, the fact is, even in the Greek, it was important at times to mention Hebrew words. So in the Greek, Hebrew words were written phonetically as well, as they are, to your astonishment, here today on your screen. This is not Hebrew. This is English, obviously, using the English alphanumeric system. But what we're writing is something phonetic so that as you read this, you would actually be speaking something close to the Hebrew, the original intention behind why James wrote this. Because he says, the cries of people that you have defrauded are reaching the Lord of Sabaoth, which is, note this, please, that James uses this term, writes it in Greek in a phonetic manner, even though it's mostly Hebrew readers that are going to read this, they would immediately connect the dots and say, he is attempting to scare us by he, Sabaoth, who is, here's the direct definition of that is the God of the armies of the stars. The God of the armies of the stars. Now, who is that? Who is the God of the armies of the stars? Who is the Lord of Sabaoth? It is Jesus. It is Jesus alone, because first of all, we know from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 2, that he created all things. Furthermore, we also know that Lucifer wanted to dethrone he who sits above the stars of heaven. We also know from Job that it was the sons of God and the great Elohim divine council that leaped with joy when that which is we know is the host of heaven what were created. But throughout Israeli or Hebraic theology is this sense that there is one that stands above all this host of heaven who is in fact the captain of all things that exist. It is Jesus. We go on to see in Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 through 3. Verse 3, and one called to the other and said, holy, holy, holy is Yahweh of the Lord of hosts, Yahweh Sabaoth, and the whole earth is full of his glory. Isaiah 44, verse 6. Thus says Yahweh, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, Yahweh of the armies of heaven, the hosts. When you see that word in the Old Testament, 99.9% of the time, it is saying Sabaoth. Why would that be repeated in the New Testament? Why is it important to scare the people of Israel into doing what is right to those who have earned by the sweat of their back their wages? Because, friends, to Israelis, nothing was more frightening. Nothing was more frightening than to be put into the hands of he who controlled the heavens that laid over them. He alone controlled these things, and when meteorites would come across the sky late at night, they truly did believe that God was sending judgment upon the earth. When lightning and thunder would strike the earth, they truly did believe that God was bringing judgment upon their weak souls. They truly did believe that there was a God in heaven that was omnipotent, all-powerful, all-seeing, all-understanding, and that for some reason this God was angry with them. Now I want to say something more to you about this. Isaiah chapter 44, verse 6 says of this Yahweh of Sabaoth, I am the first, I am the last. There is no God besides me. And interestingly enough, that very statement is used verbatim later on in the New Testament. Do you recognize it? It comes from Revelation chapter 1. In fact, as a being magnificent in appearance, one that would force he who saw him to fall dead at his feet, began to speak to John the Revelator on this in this cave on a block of salt in the Mediterranean, Patmos. It says in verse 8, that this being said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, the one who is, who was, and is, and the one who is coming, the Almighty God, Revelation 1, verse 17. And John said, when I saw him, I fell at his feet like a dead person, and he placed his right hand on me and said, do not be afraid, for I am the first and the last. What is he saying? I am the God that Isaiah spoke of. I am the God who Lucifer wanted to dethrone. I am the God whom the divine council of heaven stood and shouted for joy when I created all things, and I am the God who walked among men, who rode a dusty little donkey down a hillside on a Sunday morning. And people shouted the messianic psalms. For the matter of an hour or two in the life of Jesus' ministry, finally, Israel began to recognize that the Lord of Sabaoth was amongst them. And they laid their clothes down. They laid the palm branches down. They sang for joy. For this was the culmination of all their grand desires, their whole life. Oh, Lord, come and live amongst us. But how fickle are men's hearts, you know? For within that week, they would turn their hearts against this sweet little man. And they would yell to crucify him. Little did they know that that was the entire reason for him coming to earth. And in an instant, when he said, "Account paid in full," the earth began to shake and the stars began to fall from the sky. And all creation swelled once again in joy, for God had reigned once again. I beg you, think beyond the end of your nose today. Think about who it is that created you, put you here, placed within you this yearning to know the Almighty God. Where did I come from? Why do I exist? Why do I live today? What's my purpose? What's my goal in life? Will I ever meet a husband or a wife? Will I ever have children? Will I ever have a real job? What is retirement going to be like? Will I ever have a legacy of changing people's lives? I say to you this morning, all these and more are yours if you will follow Jesus. If you will follow Jesus. Lord God, heaven and earth has declared for millennia past that there is but one God of all heaven and earth, who by faith created all things that exist, all for the sole purpose, as all the universe points itself to this little planet Earth, as all the glory of the host of heaven point their praises to he who walked upon this earth, was spat upon in his face, was beaten and lashed, who stepped out of glory and emptied himself of everything to be nailed to a cross and to spend his blood to pay our ransom once and for all. Oh, Jesus, who could possibly be like you? Who could possibly have more love for us this morning? Friend, if you're here today, maybe you came to church this morning because you didn't want to come just one Sunday a year. Maybe you wanted others to think, well, no, I was here last Sunday too. But you know what? You're not here by mistake. The Lord God of heaven and earth has sent you here to make a decision this morning. Will you decide that who Jesus is who he said he is? The Lord God Almighty. The captain of the great armies of the stars, who loves you enough to give his life for you. Welcome him into your heart this morning by prayer. A simple prayer opens your heart, the door of your heart, to invite the Lord of all glory to come and to have fellowship, to live within you for all eternity. It changes everything, friend. No, there is a cost. It will cost you something. It will cost you your sinful life. It will cost you your sinful ideas and your sinful ways. Yes, you're going to have to change, but be of good cheer. It's not on your own power. The Holy Spirit's going to help you. The Holy Spirit is going to enable you to be a different person, someone born again. And many people today are clamoring for a new start. Many people are begging to be able to hit the reset button and just start life over. Your opportunity this morning is here to give your life to Jesus and start over. Start over. Jesus will start you over. Here's that simple prayer. Please, if this is you the Lord is speaking to, would you repeat this prayer after me? Father in heaven, I give my heart to you. I open the door of my heart to your Son, Jesus. Jesus, forgive me. Jesus, wash me. I'm so filthy. Jesus, there's so much sin in me. Jesus, I've done so much wrong. I've broken so many hearts. I've let so many people down. Jesus, wash me. Jesus, forgive me. Make me new. Give me a new start. Let me be born again, Jesus. That today and for always, even unto the end of the age, you would be with me. I accept you as my Lord and my Master. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen.